everybody. My name is David. I'm part of the Orbs research team. And we would like to tell you about something very interesting that we're doing right now. We're working on an implementation for a distributed key generation protocol that is run over Ethereum and is going to be used for generating keys for threshold BLS signatures. What we're working on specifically is a smart contract over Ethereum that is going to realize a DKG, a distributed key generation protocol, among a set of nodes or participants, right, that want to engage in such a protocol. And then they will be able to basically to do threshold signatures. What we're going to show you is a live demo of how the smart contract runs. Yeah, and this has become possible due to the very recent pre-compiled contracts that Ethereum employed. The initial motivation for that was verifying ZK snarks over Ethereum in an efficient way. It wasn't possible before the pre-compiled contracts were initiated and introduced to the protocol. We have been able to use those pre-compiled contracts for a different use case in order to realize BLS signatures and specifically threshold signatures and the DKG protocol over Ethereum. So what you see here is an environment that's based on two things, on Ganache. And Ganache, basically, it creates a virtual Ethereum network where you can deploy your contracts, you can test things, and you have fake accounts with fake balances, which are going to basically run the contract and invoke different functions in the contract. And then you have Truffle, which is an environment, a development environment for smart contracts over Ethereum. You can, you write code in Serenity, you put it into the Truffle, and these two things work together. So we have this smart contract that realizes the DKG, and in order to start the process, we have to deploy the contract into the Ethereum network. So this is what we're doing right now, and the smart contract is compiling, and great. Basically, it was included in a block. And so node number one here, the first account, is the node that deployed the contract. This is why you see a smaller balance for node number one. And let's just see the parameters of the smart contract. So we're doing a distributed key generation for 22 participants and with a threshold of 14. So that means that 15 nodes are going to be necessary in order to produce a threshold signature. So in order to join, you have to deposit 25 Ether. Okay, this basically serves as an incentivization layer over the original DKG protocol that we are implementing. Great, so let's see the first node. It's going to be this node, this account, to join the smart contract. Great, so he has joined. And he received an ID of 1. This is what you can see here. And as you can see, he has 25 Ether less because he deposited 25 Ether into the smart contract. The gas that was consumed is 55,000. Great, and now the other participants are all going to do the same. They're going to join the contract. So you can see all the balances are now reduced. And now we're basically after this phase has finished, we're now entering the second phase of the protocol, which is the commit phase, okay? The commit phase is starting. In the commit phase, basically every participant has to sample locally in his local machine some parameters, some coefficients of a polynomial. We're not going to get into the details. And he has to commit to those coefficients. And the way he does that is by sending a transaction to the smart contract that basically is going to write all of those commitments to the smart contract. So this is what's happening now. As you can see, the first node, the first participant has filed as committed to his values. And as you can see, this is a pretty big transaction. It's 2.5 million gas. And this is just, I want to emphasize that this is a very naive implementation. It's a proof of concept. In a real system, this is not going to be done as naively. And there are many ways to optimize this. Now what we're seeing is the other participants are doing the same. They're sending their commitments to the Ethereum smart contract, and the smart contract basically writes everything to its state. Great. After the commit phase has finished, what happens is that the participants, again on their local machines, verify that what the other participants have committed to is correct. It has to pass some verification where things have to match, and basically what they have for this demonstration, we set this time to 11 blocks. Of course, this can be set arbitrarily as you want, but if 11 blocks have passed and no one has filed a complaint, okay, this time basically, if you find something that goes wrong, you basically file a complaint. We're going to see this in the second demo. But in this demo, everything goes fine. 11 blocks pass and no complaint has been made. And this should ensure the participants that everybody is happy and that they can continue. And how do we continue? Basically, we can kill the contract. We could terminate the contract because everybody has the data that they need, and they can now reconstruct their secret key, and they can reconstruct the public keys of all the nodes, and they can construct the public key of the scheme itself as a whole. So basically, now anyone can terminate the contract. Okay, so this is what we're going to see now. And of course, what we are expecting is that the balances, right, are going to be returned, because the deposits are going to be returned to the participants. So as you see now, the contract has been terminated and the balances go back to 100, or, you know, a bit less because gas has been used, but this shows that the deposits have gone back. Okay, so this is all great, and now we can basically, the DKG is over. Every node has the keys that it needs in order to participate in the threshold signature scheme. And now let's just demonstrate how these keys kind of work together into creating threshold signatures. So, okay, we're going to pick a random string, and we're going to sign it very easily. So these are just the secret keys that we have printed them just for, just for you guys to see. It's not really interesting. Of course, in they don't really share those, right? Every node has to keep their secret key to themselves. And okay, so, and these are the public key shares of each node. Again, not very interesting. These are the details. So let's enter a message. Let's enter a message that says, "Hello, Orbs viewers." Great. And let's add another exclamation. Yeah, great. Okay, and now we're going to sign this message. So first thing is first, we're going to have, so this is the message in bytes, okay? And then we're going to basically produce a signature share. Every node is going to produce a signature share with his secret key share. So for example, this is a bit string, or this is in hexa, but this is basically the signature share of node number one. And now what we're going to do, we're going to take a subset of 50 nodes, and we're going to create the signature, and we're going to see that it passes verification. So let's see. So this is the first set of 50 nodes that we took, one through 15. We have reconstructed the signature from the signature shares. this is this string, and as you can see, it indeed passed verification. Now this of course everything is done in the background, but it has passed the verification of the BLS scheme that we're using. Now, as you know, BLS signature schemes are pretty cool because they produce unique signatures. So if we take another subset of, this time, nodes 1 through 16, but 5 is missing, okay, so just, I don't know, 5 is not, it's a different subset, and they're supposed to produce the same signature. So let's see how this happens. So they indeed, this is the signature, this is the group public key, or for group public key is the same, but the signature itself is, where is it? It's here. And it should match the signature here. And if you look at it, it is indeed the same. And it also passes verification, right? As we can see here, the verified signature completed successfully. Great. Now we'll take another subset of 50 nodes. This time it's these nodes here that we took, and we played with the order a little bit, and they're going to do the same thing. They're going to sign the message, and again, the message is the same as the two previous signatures. The signature is the same as the previous signatures and passes verification. And we have done many, many tests and subgroups and different messages, and this works. Great. So this is basically, we're ending, and I hope we convince you that this could work over Ethereum, and we can actually run the DKG with reasonable gas. What we want to show now is what happens if one of the participants doesn't comply to the protocol and submits false data in his commit transaction. So we're going to start everything over. So balances are back to 100. We are deploying the smart contract again. Great. Okay. It takes a second. Great. And again, we have 22 participants, threshold is 14. Okay, so now we're going to run the join phase where the participants join the contract. So this is perfect. It's okay, just as before. And now we're in the commit phase. And in the commit phase, we're now telling you we have done something to node number one. So node number one is not going to commit to the data that it should. So is the data that it's committing to doesn't match. And you're not going to see this now, because now in the commit phase, you don't see it, right? It just commits to data. So let's see that. So node number one has committed to something, and we're telling you it's false. And all the other nodes are committing to their data. Great. And now we're in the verification phase, where the clients basically do private verification of the data that the other participants have committed to. And in the specific scenario that we built here, node number two is going to see a mismatch in the data that node number one has committed to. And in this situation, what he does is he basically sends a complaint to the smart contract. So that's what he does. And as you can see, okay, this basically means that that node number two has detected a problem with node number one, with the data of node number one. So now he's sending a complaint, and he's specifically is indicating the node that he's accusing. So he's accusing node number one of being malicious, of being not honest. And let's see what happens, right? So as he presses now, basically the complaint transaction is going to be run. And if indeed the smart contract detects that node number one has cheated, then what he's going to do, he's going to take his balance, his 25 Ether, and he's going to divide it between the other participants and kill the contract. Okay, so node number one is going to stay with his low balance, and the other nodes are going to get their, they're going to be kind of compensated. But the protocol fails, so there's no keys. Okay, so let's see this happen. So he pressed. As you can see, balances of the other nodes has gone back to a little bit over 100, because 25 Ether divided by 22 is a little bit over one Ether. And the first guy is who was malicious. His balance stays low. And again, as I said, the smart contract terminates. So this implies that we're going to have to rerun the protocol if we want to generate keys, basically. I guess that's it. Thank you.